Each day, more and more people are listening to music on Spotify. And that's also true for podcasts. Next time you're on the Spotify app, make sure to follow Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond. Enjoy listening to Lou, his incredible guests, and all of the amazing episodes. Listen, follow, and share. Thrive Loud on Spotify.
Hey, Llama. Hey, how about a little something, you know, for the effort, you know? And he says, there won't be any money. But when you die, on your deathbed, you will receive total consciousness and a chance to listen to Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond. So I got that going for me, which is nice.
It's time to take an inside look at those that are taking their lives, their businesses, and their passions to the next level. Get ready to thrive loud with Lou Diamond.
Welcome, everyone, to another episode of Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond, connecting you to the most inspiring and amazing people that are thriving each and every day. I'm your host, Lou Diamond. Today on Thrive Loud, we have a screenwriter, journalist, author, and a former editor at GQ. His first book, Pitch Perfect, about the competitive world of collegiate a cappella groups, inspired the film franchise of the same name. He's written numerous articles and screenplays that are making their way to some screen or streaming service near you in the near future. In 2019, he wrote his first children's book, It's Not a Bed, It's a Time Machine, and the sequel, It's Not a School Bus, It's a Pirate Ship, just released last month. Thrive Loud listeners, former a cappella singer in his own right, Mickey Rapkin. Mickey, how are you today?
I'm great, Lou. Thanks for having me.
Excited to have you here. We have so many weird connections through both of us went to a certain university, which I'm sure will make our way through this conversation. But you have one interesting story and obviously a very well-known first book, I guess, would be the easiest way to say that. So if you could, maybe let's give the listeners a little bit of the history of how the book and then obviously into the movies that came to be, and then we'll take things from there. Is that a fair way to kick things off?
Yeah, that sounds great.
Yeah.
I was working at GQ as an editor and a writer, and I had this book agent cold call me. He was like, you know, I read some stuff of yours in the magazine, and I think you should write a book. What do you want to write a book about? And I was like, well, the only thing I want to write a book about is college a cappella group. And he thought that was a horrible idea. And he said, no, like, really, what else do you have? So for a couple of weeks, we kicked around some other ideas. And then, you know, to his credit, he came back and was like, you know, I've been thinking, if college a cappella groups is really the only thing you want to write about, let's give it a shot. So I put together this book proposal. The book would be, you know, a true story. I was going to follow these three a cappella groups on the road for a school year and write about all of the, you know, their wild adventures in the competitions and spring break and recording albums. And anyway, we put this proposal together. We sold the book. I, you know, was working at GQ still, and I would travel on the weekends for this whole school year, the 2006-2007 school year.
Right.
And I would meet up with these groups on the road, and Elizabeth Banks got a hold of the book proposal, and I got this phone call, you know, do you want to have lunch with Elizabeth Banks? She thinks this could be a good movie. I was like, sure, I'll have a lunch with Elizabeth Banks. And yeah, I mean, we met, she sat down. She was like, I love this idea. She went to the University of Pennsylvania. She knew all about a cappella groups. She's like, I want to turn this into Bring It On, but for a cappella groups. I was like, sure thing. And it sort of snowballed. But believe me, no one is more surprised than I am that we're sitting here all these years later talking about it.
So I want to rewind a little bit, because obviously your familiarity with a cappella groups comes from your own experience. Share with the listeners where you went to school and how you competed in a cappella singing?
Yes, the two, you and I, we both went to Cornell. And that's sort of the funniest part of this whole story. It feels like this amazing, sweet revenge that this kind of silly thing that so many people did in college, myself included, is now cool. I mean, I don't know, cool, but a global thing that people know about. But yeah, when I was in Cornell, I sang in this all-male a cappella group called Cayuga's Waiters. And we, you know, I knew this world. The reason I wanted to write this book is because I knew how crazy and fun this world was. You know, we would do this big concert every spring called Spring Fever at Cornell, and we would sell 2,000 tickets, and we would, you know, record these albums and go on these road trips. And it was this wild, crazy, fun world that nobody really knew about, but that all these kids like myself for years had been singing and loving it.
Let me take some rights here to say you were saying whether this was cool or not, because this is about what happened from your book. You write your book, this movie becomes more than just a happening. It becomes literally a phenomenon. For a movie to be successful is one thing. For a movie to actually spawn two sequels is another. And pair that with the country's obsession with a cappella singing as the television show Glee also is out and about around all around this same time. I mean, if you think about it, whoever that was that told you, you know, this is the wackiest idea in the world, I can't believe you want to write about a cappella singing. Obviously, you got to be at the front of the line to break down a barrier that everybody was willing to talk about. No?
Yeah, because I think what I knew at the time was, listen, I never could have predicted it would become this by any means. You know, I remember I went to the set of the first movie, and the first movie shot in Baton Rouge in Louisiana. Mm-hmm. And I showed up on, you know, they invite you down, and I went for a week, and, you know, they have these transpo guys, these transportation guys, and on every film set, and they drive everybody around. And this, you know, this was Baton Rouge, and this guy picks me up at the hotel to take me to set, and he's like a grizzled Louisiana guy. And he's like, you know, saying to me like, oh, what are you doing here on the film set? And I was like, oh, you know, I wrote the book that they based the movie on. And he was like, man, that's amazing. He's like, we're really all pulling for this movie. We love these kids. We think it's going to be a hit. And I was like, wow. I was shocked. I was like, if this guy is pulling for this a cappella movie, I was like, maybe this will be something. But the crazy thing is the first movie actually came out and it did fine.
Yeah.
But it wasn't really a thing until it was on TV.
Yep.
Until it was on HBO and stuff, because all of these, I don't know, all of these, like, I guess dudes, like the number of guys that came up to me and have been like, or fathers, you know, all these people were like, man, I never would have seen that movie in the theater. Then I saw it on HBO. My kids loved it. And I was like, oh my God, this is pretty cool. All of those people, it was kind of like the Austin Powers effect. Like the first Austin Powers movie, like, wasn't a big hit in theaters. Then it blew up on TV and video. And then by the time the second movies came out, it was a massive thing.
I'm going to give the listeners some stats here. And these are just North American numbers. I can't give global numbers. But this was the first movie did $65 million in the box office, which, by the way, is unbelievable unto itself. But let's just leave it at that. But the second movie did $184 million. And the third also broke $100 million. That's incredible any way you look at it, and is a franchise. And obviously launched the careers of many actors, actresses, and obviously Elizabeth Banks's fame has only grown from that as well. So talk about a good meeting. It looked like you both won in that conversation.
Yeah, I mean, she is an amazing, amazing powerhouse of a person. She and her husband, Max Handelman, who went to college together, they have this company, Brownstone. But she, exactly what she said was going to do, she did. You know, she brought in this amazing writer, Kay Cannon, who at the time was working on 30 Rock. And she was like, we're going to make it, Bring It On. And this is going to be the opening scene. Like, they were, these two amazing women went out and like made this thing happen. And then Jason Moore, they brought in this amazing director. But it was Elizabeth Banks is really like, she was the one who saw what this whole thing could be. When I was sitting there, I mean, talk about like the business that she took it to Universal to get them to option the book. And they sent over this contract and I didn't even have a lawyer read it. I mean, this contract weighed like 50 pounds. I mean, it was like a phone book showed up at my desk at GQ. And I was like, let me sign this contract and send it back immediately before they realize they've made a huge mistake. Like I didn't even read the thing because I was like, who would ever make a movie about a cappella groups? So yeah, I mean, she just, which is just all to say, she's an amazing visionary producer.
Well, let's not.
And director, she directed the second one, and also is hilarious in all the movies.
She's so funny, and for those who are trying to identify who Elizabeth Banks is, she's the basically the play-by-play commentator.
Yes,
in the background, yes, trying to provide the play-by-play of the on the road versions of the a cappella singing groups going throughout. It's pretty impressive. Okay, but I want to talk about you here because this is interesting. Writing has obviously been something that you've been passionate about, and there's different ways of writing when you were writing articles, screenplays, books. There's a process that has to go through in your mind on how you do this. Before we get to what you're writing now, I want to talk about the stuff you were writing about. Are you a disciplined writer, Mickey? Are you one of those I need to, you know, set myself in a time window, or the ideas just kind of flow and that's how they come out of you?
It's funny that you asked that. I feel like the only skill I have is discipline. So many people with much, much, much greater talent than I could ever have. You know, when I worked at GQ, these writers were amazing. I learned from some incredible people there, but I always felt like all of these people are way more talented than I am. So the only thing I can do is just work and work and work and work. You know, I used to work, I live in Los Angeles now, but I always lived in New York, and I would be working on these ideas on the weekends, and I would sit at these coffee shops writing, and I had this sort of rotation of places I would go to, and I would always see Malcolm Gladwell sitting there, this guy, Danny Strong, who wrote that amazing HBO movie, the name is escaping me, about John McCain and Sarah Palin. What was that movie called?
Danny Strong. Danny Strong is the writer, right?
Yes, he was the writer. But he also created Empire, and he's an incredible writer. But anyway, I would see him. I would see Malcolm Gladwell. Right. And I'd be like, and it would be like a Saturday at 10 a.m. I was like, oh, these guys are so successful. And even they are like grinding it out at 10 a.m. on a Saturday on a weekend. I was like, everyone, even the most successful people, just work and work and work and work and work.
Well, I think that's always true. I think, you know, it's very funny. When people hit fame or success, we only hear or see that moment of the success, and no one understands how much hard work or how much failure or how many things didn't work out well before that. And I think it's kind of like, obviously it's weird. It's like the opposite of news. You ever notice that only the bad news shows up on TV and you only hear the bad stories, and
right,
the real good stories never make the headlines. But in capturing someone's story or their bio or fame, it's always, oh, the good news. But meanwhile, the majority of the hard work behind it never gets the accolades and recognition that it does. Do you feel that too in your world?
Yeah, I mean, it was like, well, first of all, Pitch Perfect, the movie, you know, the book came out in 2008. It was optioned right away. And then the movie came out, it took 4 years to get the movie made. And in Hollywood, that's considered like warp speed almost. Mm. But when I was writing that book and traveling to meet those kids, I was, you know, I would leave, I took a lot of Fridays off, and I would leave on Thursday night, fly to meet these kids on the road, sometimes fly back Monday morning, go right to the office for that whole school year. And then I was, you know, the book, there's a deadline, you know, you got to meet a deadline. It takes so long for a book to actually come out after you turn it in. So the deadline, like, you don't want to miss a deadline because it's going to push the book, you know, 6 months. So I was getting up and I would sit in at the time the GQ office was in Times Square, and I would sit in Bryant Park in the morning at like, you know, 8 a.m. or 7:30 and write for a couple of hours before I'd go into the office. And then I would write at night. Like, it's really sadly, there's no one's going to do the work for you. You just have to do it.
Totally true. I'm just realizing what a weird mirrored similar life you have to another famous Cornelian who worked at a magazine, who wrote a book that became a big movie, and that's The Devil Wears Prada and Lauren Weisberger. And yes. I'm realizing, you know, you had the GQ side, she was working at Vogue.
At Vogue, yeah.
And you're actually graduated close to the same time. That's kind of unbelievable, actually, when you think about career paths heading in certain ways. Different reaction and reactions anyway, but that's kind
yeah,
of...
Yeah, it's so
did you
funny.
Ever realize
we just,
that?
Hey, did we... We're at school at the same time. I think she graduated maybe 1 year ahead.
Yeah, 99 she graduated. Yep.
Right, she graduated in 99. I graduated in 2000. And I knew we had friends in common and it would come up over the years, but I have actually never met Lauren.
Not too funny. It's for another podcast show.
Yeah, exactly.
Get there on another piece. So I want to go drive down this channel with you because so writing is part of your discipline. And only recently, obviously, you've been doing a lot of screenplays and different articles that might turn into some programming, but now you're writing children's books. Can you explain how you made that transition?
Yeah, it's so funny. I was like, I'm out here in LA and you're writing these screenplays and you don't know how, when, if ever they'll get made, even when you sell them. And then I'm also writing these articles. And it's just like, it's nice sometimes just to have something come out, you know, because when you write these movies, you're just like, is anyone going to see this? So anyway, I had this idea for a children's book, and to flash back really far, I had been a kindergarten teacher for 1 year right after college.
Okay, very cool.
And I had this class, basically I could never understand why these kids hated bedtime. To me, it was like bedtime was amazing. You know, it's like, it's nighttime, you get into bed, you close your eyes, and suddenly like 9 hours have passed and there's breakfast on the table. I was like, that's not a bed, it's a time machine. So I was like trying to rebrand bedtime as something to look forward to. And I don't have kids, but I have all these friends who have kids, and I was constantly, you know, helping out and reading bedtime stories, and I have a niece and nephew, and I was like, I'm gonna sit down and write a children's book. Why not? And my same agent, the one who helped sell Pitch Perfect the book, he was like, I was like, hey, Farley, I want to write a children's book. He's like, okay. He's like, give it a shot. So anyway, I sat down and I wrote this.
He's never going to question you again.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, he's like the best guy in the world. But I sat down and I wrote a children's book, and we sent it around to a bunch of people. And, you know, this amazing editor at Imprint at Macmillan, she called me and she's like, hey, I love this idea. This is like 5 times too long. She's like, children's books have to be like 250 words. This is crazy long, but I really love this idea. And she was like, I'll take a flyer on you. And we worked on it together. And she brought in this amazing illustrator, Teresa Martinez. And it was just like, it's just sort of a testament to believing in an idea, you know, and thinking, you can do it. You know, why not? I didn't wait for somebody to come to me to say, hey, have you thought about a children's book? You know, I just had an idea and I thought, you know what, I'm just going to sit down and write it.
I think it's great. You know, I've had the pleasure of speaking through the Bedside Reading Authors That Thrive podcast, which spins off of Thrive Loud, that we've had all these amazing authors and recently have had a few children's best-selling authors, and realizing what a unique skill it is, because it's a whole process. It's not only getting that really good story, there's an animation component, an illustration piece of it, to piece it together. And it's really funny how you say this has to be 250 words is basically what it is. That's really hard to do for an article that you would have to do.
Oh, no, it's like the tiny amount of words, and every word counts, and the pictures have to, you know, she gave me the best advice. She said, the words shouldn't work without the pictures, and the pictures shouldn't work without the words.
Right.
I was like, oh, that's amazing. So I sat with that and I tweaked the story, and then the book came out and I went on the, you know, I did a little book tour, and that was the best part. You know, I saw all these kids and I, you know, got to put on my silly voices and read the book in these bookstores. And I was like, you know what, I'm going to make this a series, because in the same way that you should look forward to bedtime, you can turn bedtime into an adventure. The same was true of, you know, getting on the school bus. You know, I remember being a kid and really the whole series is about anxiety. You know, like kids have this anxiety and they don't know they don't have the vocabulary to talk about it. And sometimes the parents don't have the vocabulary, but you can turn some of these things you're anxious about into an adventure. So I remember being nervous. I would get on the bus and who's going to sit with me? And what if nobody sits with me? And what if nobody talks to me? And I was like, you know what? I'm going to make this school bus an adventure. So the sequel, you know, is it's not a school bus, it's a pirate ship.
Right.
So, you know, the same little boy gets on the bus and his mom's like, you know, you don't have anything to be worried about. Like, you're the master of mornings, the captain of cool. And he gets on and he meets a friend and they turn this whole adventure to get to school into, you know, a pirate sing along. And
I look forward to it's not a playground, it's a spaceship. And you could take the, go ahead and take the next step.
Exactly.
The
exactly.
Mickey, I want to ask this question because
it's
obviously evident and our listeners can hear it because I'm hearing it. You love to be around or to also perform. Has that been something that's been in you in your entire life, whether it's from your singing, from reading the stories to the children, and obviously helping to produce not only books, but books that turn into productions and movies? So has performance been something in your entire life that's always been at front and center?
Yes. You know, I performed a bunch, you know, in high school plays and that sort of thing. And then I got to Cornell and I actually auditioned for the a cappella group like 4 times. I was like, they kept turning me down, you know, and you'll remember at Cornell, there's like something like 20 a cappella groups.
Wow.
You know, there's so many, you know, all male groups, all female groups, co-ed groups. There's a Jewish a cappella group, you know, there's a million different groups. But I was fixated on this one group, you know, because I would see them perform around campus and they were look like they were having more fun than anybody else. And I just wanted to be a part of that. So I kept going, you know, I would try out again and again. And finally they, I don't know, saw something in me or took pity on me. Either way, I'll take it. But yeah, I've always, you know, it's funny. I'm also one of those people who gets nervous before a show, nervous before meetings and public speaking. Like I want to, you know, vomit before sometimes I would do these interviews for magazines and I would always think like, you know, you do tons of preparation for the interview and then the time comes for the phone call. And I was always think like, please, I hope they cancel, like right up until I got on the phone. But then of course, as you can tell, once I get into it, I do really enjoy it, which has been one of the many, you know, sad things about this pandemic is just not being around people.
No, I totally get it. Although, you know, look, people are trying. They're trying to connect. I was just recently saw the cast of Hamilton did a performance on Zoom that they were trying to get to everybody. And so other Broadway shows are doing the same thing.
Yeah, no, it's amazing.
Connect. It's really great. And look, we all hope we get back there soon.
Of course.
I do want to highlight something that you just mentioned. You talked about the stress, the anxiety on yourself for trying out. I recognize that actually is what made the Pitch Perfect movie so successful was the auditions or those trying to get into the groups. It was really fun.
You know, I love that sequence in the first movie where you see the kids auditioning because that is exactly what it is. You know, this wide variety of people, some who can sing, some who can't sing at all, but who are sort of drawn to this fun and excitement and really camaraderie. I mean, what these a cappella singing groups and really what anything is about is this like trying to find a family. You know, you come to college and you know, Cornell's a huge place and you're really trying to find your family and where you fit in. And that's a fraternity, a sorority, an a cappella group, a science club, you know, whatever it is.
Mickey, I love asking guests on this program this question, and this is going to be interesting to see where this goes. We all have days where we're not kicking on all cylinders and we're not quite thriving. When we're having one of those days, and you specifically, what practice do you seek, or what individual do you seek out to get back on the thriving track?
I'm going to give you 2 answers. On a good day, I go for a run. I'm a big runner. I do between 5 and 7 miles 5 times a week. And whenever I'm in a bad mood or when I'm stuck on something I'm writing and I can't figure out the answer, whatever it is, I go for a run. And I do my best thinking when I'm exercising.
Nice.
But the flip side of that is on really bad days where I'm really angry at myself and really frustrated, I go to Shake Shack. It's gross. I'm not proud of it, but everyone, I feel like the closest people in my life know, like, if I've had like a Shake Shack burger and a vanilla milkshake, that like something has really gone wrong. I'll flee there and sort of quietly eat it in my car.
I'm going to jump in on this topic. First of all, I happen to like Shake Shack.
Oh, it's delicious.
And I will also say this is interesting because you now live in Los Angeles. And obviously you have the In-N-Out burgers out there as well. So like, I know that's like, I when I land in California, my first goal is to get to an In-N-Out burger before I can do anything.
People here are, there's a huge diehard community of In-N-Out. I know so many people just like you, the second they land, you know, they get their rental car and they go to In-N-Out. 10 out of 10 times think Shake Shack is better. But I know that everybody has their own, it's a big debate.
It is. And the other point I was going to make on this is that I just listened to Danny Meyer's interview on How I Built This on Guy Raz's program. And it was so funny because I remembered when the first one popped up in Madison Square Park. It was basically like a hot dog stand. And
totally.
I mean, it turned into a $1 billion enterprise. And their shakes are better than anybody's. That's without a doubt. It's like they're almost illegal.
That shake is so good.
It's too good. I never in my mind thought I would have heard that answer. That's one of the best. When I'm really having a bad day, Shake Shack gets me back.
It's really true.
That's awesome. Let's do this. Let's do the admin part of the show, Mickey. Share with the listeners all the places people can find you, learn about the children's book, websites, things like that. We will put it all in the show notes. However, it always gets more engagement when they hear it directly from you.
Great. So for the books, you can go to my website. It's just mickeyrapkin.com, M-I-C-K-E-Y, like the song, Rapkin, R-A-P-K-I-N, mickeyrapkin.com. All the information about the children's books are there. There's an Instagram for the children's book. It's at Boss of Bedtime, which is one of the things the kids say. They're like, you can be the boss of bedtime. And those are the two best spots. You should check me out.
Okay, we're going to head down Fun Street here. Permission to. Can we go down that
please.
Pathway? I'm excited for it. Okay. We'll start off, first of all, what's your all-time favorite movie?
You've Got Mail.
Okay, why does that movie connect so much with you?
Two things. One reminds me of it reminds me of New York, like a beautiful happenstance of meeting people and the sort of romance of walking around New York and New York in the fall. And it makes me laugh. And also my dad, who is sadly no longer with us, that was one of his favorite movies. So whenever I see it on TV, I always sort of think it's my dad like waving.
Nice touch. I like it. Okay. Because we're going to go through our speed round here on Fun Street, and this should be fun. Basically, I'm going to say a bunch of things, whatever comes first to mind that makes you happy kind of a thing is what you'll relay. It's, as I was telling you before we started, it's kind of like Family Feud in the speed round, just we haven't surveyed 100 people. Okay. a favorite song you love to listen to that pumps you up?
Oh, that pumps me up. Britney Spears, Work, Bitch.
A favorite food that's not a dessert?
Pizza.
Favorite food that is a dessert?
Ice cream.
An activity you wish you did more of?
Called my family.
An activity you wish you did less of?
Worry.
If you could snap your fingers and go anywhere, where are you?
Tokyo.
Lastly, when you think about a cappella singing, and was there a favorite song that you or the Cayuga Waiters, which was the group you were in college, loved to perform more than any other?
Love the one you're with. I didn't sing it, but it was, I feel like whenever we did that one at a show, everyone in the group was excited. It was a fun one.
So I'm going to end this show here with just one last question, and actually more of a chance for you to open a comment. You've been an incredibly fortunate and successful writer. And I know you're one of those people who appreciates the good fortune around that. With the children's books going on and other things, is the writing of the children's book and that conciseness helping with your other writing? And what would you share with other writers out there that might be looking to do the same thing? Lessons you've learned. I think just you could sum that up. Yeah. That's a lot to put in.
I mean, you're right. I am so grateful and feel like the luckiest person on earth. You know, I wrote this little book. I'm lucky enough to see Elizabeth Banks and Max Handelman, her husband, I always tell them, like, I always thank them. I was like, you changed my life. And in terms of the writing, writing a tight, concise story that has a beginning and middle and end where a character changes, like a children's book, does make you think about economy and other things that you're writing. Absolutely. And just thinking about making every story beat count. When you're working on a script, when you're working on anything, like if something hasn't changed by the end of the scene is not necessary.
Mickey Rapkin, truly a pleasure to have you on. Continued success in everything you do. We'll make sure to push all the links to these amazing children's books. And obviously we'll put some other links to that other type of stuff you were doing in the past.
Thank you.
And I hope you had fun today.
Yes.
You had fun?
I did. Thank you so much for having me. It was such a great way to start a day.
You got it. And to all our listeners out there, thank you for joining us. And until next time, keep thriving onward and upward. And remember, be brief, be bright, be gone.
You've been listening to Thrive Loud with your host, Lou Diamond. Check us out on the web at thriveloud.com and follow us on Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook at Thrive Loud. And check us out on the Good Pods app at Thrive Loud, where you can follow, listen, and connect directly to Lou and all of the Thrive Loud episodes. Thanks for listening.